This is Computer Networks, Chapter 1, Part 2, where we're going to look at network connections, packet switching, and delays. We learned last time that a network consists of a group of computers that are connected to share some resource. In this section, we're going to look at different ways to actually connect those computers. Of all the different network technologies that we're going to look for, selecting one is typically going to be driven by the needed capacity, the needed reliability, and the overall cost. You are probably most familiar with one of the most low-cost networks, which is the home network. This network is split at the front door. The service provider is responsible for the cable coming into the home. And the homeowner is responsible for the internal network running through the walls or the wireless network. It is not uncommon today to see close to 100 different devices on a home network. And if you think about the number of different computers, printers, cell phones, game consoles, smart TVs, internet-connected appliances, and the emerging Internet of Things, home networks today are starting to feel just a little bit crowded. Although still not common, many upscale homes have high-speed Ethernet wiring installed right into the walls of the home, while most others depend on high-speed Wi-Fi. The telecom providers, typically the old-fashioned telephone company or the cable company, maintain massive trunk lines that serve all of the customers in a particular region. And the real struggle is to get with a home network has always been what we call the last mile problem, or getting from that central office trunk line to your front door. We'll take a look at this in more detail on some upcoming slides. However, the most common technologies that you'll see are, for home internet anyway, are digital subscriber lines, or DSL, or cable modems. One other technology, fiber to the home, has had a very, very slow progression because of the high cost, the need to be able to recover those high costs by deploying into very dense areas and then charging a lot of money to the end users. And so while fiber to the home can often be significantly faster than either DSL or cable, it also tends to be much more limited and much more expensive. Today, there's a lot of hype about 5G cellular technology. Ultra-high band 5G, and this is not what's going to be inside your iPhone. It relies on frequencies in the 25 to 39 gigahertz range to achieve download speeds of several gigabits per second. Unfortunately, it only goes over very short distances and typically only line of sight. Telcos are hoping to be able to leverage this to solve what they call the last few feet problem. You can imagine a dense housing development. Each home has a 5G repeater on their house, and the whole development meshes together to form a multi-gigabit broadband cell. The service provider would need only install one high-speed but very expensive trunk to the whole region. The idea is that the company then could easily recoup that investment and provide low-cost, low-latency, and very high-speed network access to everybody in the housing development. We'll be sure to revisit this emerging technology later in this semester. Today, small businesses have to deal with networking in ways that they never imagined. Consider a busy restaurant with hundreds of people trying to use their mobile phone at the same time as the front of the house are trying to get orders into the back of the house or the kitchen, or the coffee shop that has become a remote office for many people. Despite having these extra demands, small businesses have the same last mile problem as most home users. Businesses have the additional problem of not being able to trust many of their users while having to expose and but yet protect many of their vital network assets. So while the technologies are similar between home and small business, the use cases and the problems that they face and the stakes are even higher. You can imagine a restaurant who is trying to do secure credit card processing but also provide the convenience of accessing the internet to their customers. It's not as easy of a problem as one might think. Enterprise systems are installed in large organizations that need to support many thousands of users. Often, because of their needs, these organizations are willing to spend the money to fix the last mile problem and have high-performance fiber optics or even microwave transceiver stations installed to their network operations centers. For example, this is an enterprise version of a core router, significantly more powerful than what you would find in any home, most homes. Consider the campus network that needs to support everyone's daily activities. We have multi-gigabit connections to the internet, and our on-campus connections are typically directly wired gigabit connections. Our routers and switchers are very much like this big guy that we have over here. Our high-capacity switches can handle many gigabits per second. The campus backbones are rated in the 10 gigabit per second, and parts of it are even being upgraded to be even faster. The routers and switches are all high performance, they're all high capacity, and they can all be centrally managed, and they can handle significant loads placed by all of our users. A few years ago, it was always a frightening day to be a network administrator in a large campus when Apple would release a new operating system. I remember the University of Maryland's network was actually overwhelmed by all of the iPhone users downloading the latest update. And there was no network fix for that. Apple changed the way that they deliver their software. And so it's just really fascinating how users can overwhelm even the biggest technology. The technologies that are used for accessing local area networks has basically standardized today on wired or wireless Ethernet. For the most part, LAN connections are copper wires, typically unshielded, twisted pair wiring, or what we call UTP. Sometimes we'll just nickname it the blue cable, but they're really not always blue. Early versions of Ethernet were limited from 1 to 10 megabit per second. But due to advances in signaling technology, better wiring, better network hardware, better software, speeds to a desktop today are typically between 100 megabit and 1 gigabit per second. Today, computers can even support up to 10 gigabit per second, but that's still seldom deployed directly to the desktop. It's just too expensive, and 99.9% of us don't need it. Instead, the 10 gigabit and the emerging 100 gigabit per second networks are being used to link network infrastructure devices to create LAN backbones. 10 gigabit per second is effectively as fast as we can get with copper wiring, but through clever signaling strategies, we can actually run different channels or lanes on the same cable at the same time. So when we're talking about 10 gigabit per second, what we're really talking about are 10 gigabit channels at the same time. Wi-Fi, or just wireless, has become one of the most common ways of accessing a LAN. It has many advantages, from ease of deployment and minimal physical installation requirements. It also has some significant disadvantages. Security is the first thing that comes to my mind. But it also has poor performance when there are lots of different devices. In dense areas, such as college residence halls and apartments, it can be difficult to find an available channel for a Wi-Fi router, and everyone's performance is you're all trying to compete for the same few available channels, and performance suffers. Two other technologies that you may encounter for local networks are InfiniBand and Fibre Channel, but these tend to be deeply embedded into data centers. For example, InfiniBand is used to network nodes of supercomputers together and to attach dedicated peripherals. Wide area networks can span cities. Sometimes they get called then metropolitan area networks, or MANs. WANs often span large geographic regions. Given the large distances and installation costs, these networks are typically pushing the state of the art in speed and reliability at the time. Cost is also a major factor in determining that these trunk lines typically go from central office to central office. To be cost-effective, these CO connections need to be shared between a large number of customers in hopes of being able to recoup the expense of installation. This gives rise to that last mile problem that we talked about. Getting data from the CO to the endpoint requires making trade-offs between installation and maintenance costs, as well as speed and the ability for the service provider to recover those costs. This picture shows an undersea fiber optic cable bundle. On the next slide, we'll look at how they actually make and install these cables. But to give a perspective, this Monet cable system that they talk about in this next video is a modern fiber trunk, and it can handle 64 terabits per second aggregate bandwidth across a 10,000 kilometer link. And so certainly the data that's being, that cable is being shared by a number of different providers. To solve that last mile problem, we have a number of different tools, which we've already mentioned. We may have the DSL, the digital subscriber line. We may use the DOCSIS protocol, which is also just called the cable modem. We may see fiber optic to the home, FTTH. In places where it's difficult to get hard landlines installed, you may see things like satellite. Right now, the Starlink network is hoping to become the predominant internet provider for a lot of Americans through their new satellite network. Some cities are actually sponsoring metropolitan Wi-Fi, and so you'll have city-provided wireless access. This is often in Europe more so than in the United States. But you'd get free Wi-Fi service that covers an entire city, and so you would need to maintain your own. Some people resort to using their cellular modem or their cell phone as a modem for their computer. And finally, some people just have to resort to dial-up, where you make a phone call with your telephone modem and you're stuck at dial-up speeds, which typically stop at 56 kilobit per second, which is not really all that fast. Sometimes it's really hard to believe that in the country that started the internet and that gave birth to Silicon Valley and the tech giants, that we have lost the global lead and access to the internet. In a recent survey, the United States is 10th in the world in average broadband speeds. We are far behind other countries in peak home broadband speeds. For what access we do have, we tend to pay way more than many other developed countries where governments offset some of the costs either through subsidies directly to subscribers or through government investment in infrastructure. While nearly 80% of people in the United States have some access to the internet, that term access is very broad, and for many, especially in rural or impoverished areas, the only access to the internet is through a cell phone, which is one of the most expensive and least flexible methods of accessing the net. In 2019, less than 35% of the U.S. population had access to what the FCC calls high-speed broadband. In the U.S., the FCC defines broadband service as at least 25 megabits per second down and 3 megabits per second up, which by today's standards is really not that fast. When we talk about cost, for example, as of June 2020, CenturyLink charges $50 per month for speeds of up to 10 megabit per second broadband to downtown Shippensburg. And so they are still calling it broadband, even though it doesn't even meet the FCC's minimum definition. And 10 megabit per second broadband is barely enough to be functional on the internet. And for that $50 a month, or about $600 a year, that can be a crippling expense, where the median household income in Shippensburg is $37,000 a year, and nearly 20% of the population lives in poverty. It is clear that something needs to change in our culture. As the recent pandemic demonstrated, people need access to the internet to do work, to attend classes. In the middle of the pandemic, they needed internet even to attend church. Access to the internet is needed to apply for benefits, to apply for new jobs when your old one is lost. It has become a necessary tool for life in our technological society. Access to the internet has become as important as electricity. It is no longer just a convenience. And while lack of access can actually make it harder to climb out of poverty. Unfortunately, in the United States, we have regulatory bodies to regulate utilities and require them to provide minimum viable services. We have public utility boards that set price caps and encourage competition among utilities. But we don't treat the internet as a utility, even though both cable and telephone companies are regulated as utilities. In other countries, the government provides a competitive service which forces private companies to either offer better quality, higher speeds, or the same speed but at reduced price. But we have the worst of both worlds, and as a result, only those who can afford the astronomically high prices can get truly high-speed internet, while the rest of us live in an internet desert. In fact, the vast majority of us live in an internet desert. Let's take a few minutes and listen to this. It's a four-minute soundbite from NPR talking about the struggle of teachers and students as a result of this pandemic. So hopefully that gives you something to think about. Maybe if your experience is like that, because many parts of Pennsylvania is very rural and struggles to provide high-speed internet access, whereas others may live in cities where the cost is just too high. Or maybe you have fiber to your home and you're used to 2 gigabit connection download speeds. But all of that illustrates the fact that there is a big difference in people's ability to access the net. I'm actually surprised, based on where I live here in Shippensburg, that we've been able to maintain at least a reasonable network connection over the last 15 years. It hasn't always been the case. So anyway, there's some food for thought.
One in four.
So networks are all about connecting endpoints, and there are really three ways that we have to do this. The first is directly connect the endpoint together with wires. This was how the early telegraph systems worked, but then those wires were dedicated to those stations, and when they weren't being used, that capacity was wasted. Later, we learned that we could do what's called circuit switching, and you can kind of see a picture of it here in this animated GIF. During circuit switching, wires are connected on demand, either manually or using some multiplexing strategy. For example, back in the old days, when you wanted to make a phone call, you would call from your home to the telephone central office and say, "Hello, operator, I would like to call New York City." And the operator would figure out the closest central office to get there. And so they would make a connection to say, from Shippensburg, you might get to Harrisburg. The Harrisburg operator would be like, "Oh, you're going to New York City. All right, I don't have a path directly to New York City. Let me patch you through to Scranton." And then Scranton would get you into New York City. And then the New York City operator would figure out who you're trying to call and get your phone connected to that phone. And eventually, through all those patch cords, you would literally have had an electrical connection between your phone and somebody else's phone. Obviously, we don't do that anymore, but that's literally the way that it used to work. Later on, we created the idea of what's called a virtual circuit. And in a virtual circuit, what we're going to do is we're going to install these big trunk lines, and we're going to carve up ways of accessing those trunk lines. And we can do this in about three common different ways, one of which is called circuit switching, where we'll allocate these wires, kind of like what these ladies are doing, but we'll do it on demand with computers and do it very fast. Other technique, the kind of most common technique, is called packet switching. And in packet switching, what we're going to do is we're going to inject data into the network, and while your data is in transport, you have the full access to the network. But because your data is so small relative to the speed of the network, somebody else can be putting data in right behind you. And so we can keep sharing these limited resources ourselves. And then the last one is what are called lease lines. And for the longest time, you could go to the telephone company and you could actually lease bandwidth on these trunk lines, and they were guaranteed to be yours. So, for example, if I leased a 1.5 megabit connection to some other central office of my own, nobody else's data would be able to interfere with that. you can imagine those lease lines were not terribly cheap. But that's kind of what you had to do to be able to get data from here to there. Circuit switching allows multiple devices to be active, but only one at a time. A technique called multiplexing is used to take multiple streams of data and encode them as one, and then reverse the process on the receiving side. The two most common techniques to do this are frequency division multiplexing, or FDM, and time division multiplexing, or TDM. FDM allocates different frequencies to each channel, and then each channel can send data simultaneously. So we can think of radio or television stations where we can tune in a radio station and I can listen to that radio station even though all of the radio stations around me are broadcasting at the same time. But since there are physical limits to how much data can be sent at a time, it also then limits the amount of available bandwidth on each channel. So I can't have some infinitely fast single channel out of all of the airwaves, for example. The other thing is that these channels have to be spaced far enough apart so that they don't interfere with one another, and that starts to limit, you start getting fast channels and slow channels and channels that don't work quite so well. So FDM is less commonly used in wired networks, whereas time division multiplexing is more commonly used. In time division multiplexing, what we're going to do is we're going to allocate to several different channels a certain amount of time, a slot. And for each time slot, we're going to essentially take a packet from one channel and put it into the wire, and then we'll take a packet from the next slot and put it into the wire, and then we'll do the same thing for the third. And we can kind of see that happening here in this picture, where we have these three different channels all kind of converging into one, and each of the packets of each of the different frames go out. The trick about TDM, though, is that if we're not using that particular slot, then it just goes idle. But that's the price you pay to have guaranteed delivery of data. Probably the best example of this TDM was the telephone company's T carrier, and that was kind of first introduced in 1962. By the 1960s, the telephone network's growth demanded increasing capacities in the carrier's trunk lines. Further, companies themselves started expanding the number of telephone lines, and the telco needed to keep up with that demand. By the end of the 1960s, demand for data was increasing as well. Bell Labs, the phone company, developed the T carrier system, a type of trunk line that could be run across the entire country, or from telco office to telco office. There may be several T3 lines run between big cities, and each one of those T3 lines, if we look here at the graph, it can handle up to 672 simultaneous calls. However, so for instance, maybe from Harrisburg to Philadelphia, there might have been a T3 line. And then from Harrisburg to Shippensburg, there might have only been a single T1 line, and that only allowed 24 simultaneous voice channels to be used. We've probably never in our lifetime have ever heard the message, cannot complete call, all circuits busy, because the capacity of the telephone network is just so large. But that was actually a fairly common problem back in this period of time. These lines could only hold so many simultaneous phone calls, and then they would have to start telling people, nope, can't make that call. And then the telephone company would know it's time to go and increase the trunk sizes. At this time, one can rent part of a trunk or an entire trunk, but they're not cheap. And they are certainly beyond the reach of most homeowners. Maybe Bill Gates has them, I don't know. I tried to find average costs for some of these things. So the older T1, T2, and T3 lines, these were the original trunk lines that were installed, copper wire kind of things. And you know, you could still lease a T1 line. Gives you the 24 voice channels. Runs between $250 to $500 a month. So that's like for 24 phone lines. It's not bad. You can still rent a T3 line, and that's going to give you 44 megabit upload and download speed, but it's going to run you between $4,000 and $16,000 a month. OC3 would give you the equivalent of 100 T1s. It'll give you 155 megabits down. And the average price in the United States for this service is between $20,000 to $45,000 a month. I could not find any pricing for any of the other services, and most likely because everyone is going to end up being charged differently based on how far away they are from the nearest central office and how much capacity that central office has. You know, it may be, for instance, if I were to go to a telephone company and say I want an OC96 from my home here in Shippensburg to Shippensburg University, they don't have anything to support that. They would have to custom install it and then recoup that cost by charging me an arm and a leg. So either way, not cheap. But that's the business model for the telephone company. Another form of sharing the wires is what's called packet sharing. And the idea was conceived after watching how computers actually use these network wires to send data. Computers often spend a time processing on the CPU and then doing I/O. It's that I/O, CPU-I/O cycle that computers operate in. And as a result, they tend to send data in bursts. So the computer is going to chunk and churn on the CPU for a little bit, and then it's going to send out the data that it's just computed, or it's going to read in something new to do. A burst comprises sending one chunk of data, or what we'll come to call a packet, to some receiver, and then waiting for some reply. And during those idle periods, the wires that move the packets back and forth can then be used by some other computer. And so an advantage to packet sharing is that we can theoretically have many computers talking to many computers all at the same time. What we're going to do, though, is we're going to impose some rules to help prevent one computer from owning the network and preventing other computers from sending packets along those wires, or what we call starvation. And sometimes we'll do a first come, first serve, or you know, sometimes we'll do some other rules. If nobody is transmitting any data, we still have some unused capacity. And while there are many sources transmitting, we can certainly overwhelm the capacity of the network. And it can be really difficult to allocate bandwidth to each computer equally and fairly. So in theory, the same transmission lines can be used by many computers, each getting the full bandwidth of the transmission lines. But on the other hand, with the wrong mixture of traffic, we can overwhelm and bog down the transmission lines and really degrade the performance pretty significantly. In the previous example, we talked about how, or previous slide, we talked about how packet switching can either make great use of the network resources, or it can make very poor use of the network resources. It's just depending on how computers are communicating with each other. So let's think about what it would look like if we had, say, four computers. And just to make things easy, I'm going to call one computer A, B, C, and D. And in between them, we're going to assume that there's some kind of a network switch that's going to allow me to exchange packets between them. So it's pretty clear that if A is putting a packet out on the network, B could also be putting a packet out onto the network. And so if we assume that like A is sending that packet to C, and B is sending that packet to D, what we can do is we can actually look at like what do these network links look like over time. And so we have the link of A going to its switch. And we have the link of B going to its switch. And we have C going to its switch. And we have D going to its switch. And so for some unit of time, when A is sending a packet to C, we're going to just call that A to C, it can be, you know, busy sending that data. And in fact, while B is sending to D, that can happen at the exact same time. Now, if it's a really good switch, C could actually be sending to another device on this network as well. So for instance, we could say that C is going to deliver a packet onto A, for example. So we'll draw a little line back. And D is delivering a packet back to, so we have C going back to A. And we can send D back to B. Once these packets are done, kind of separate these in time, then we can see that, you know, we're ready for the next packet. And in this one time t, we actually got four packets. And in fact, all of these links were transmitting data at full speed. So let's say that these were 100. Let's make a gigabit, keep the math a lot easier. 1 gigabit per second connections. Then, you know, while we're transmitting, we actually got 4 gigabit per second moving through the network. So that would be a really, really efficient use of the wires. Unfortunately, we can also see really bad luck. So let's pick the same four machines and the same switch and the same four wires. And we're going to have device A, B, C, and D. But instead of people kind of talking to one another, what we're going to do is we're going to make everybody talk to node A. And so what we can do here is we can say that B is trying to send data to A, D is trying to send data to A, and C is trying to send data to A. And if I were to try to draw this on the graph, we have A communicating to the switch, we have B communicating to the switch, C communicating to the switch, and D communicating to the switch. Well, in this picture, I'm not showing that A is doing anything. So we're just going to leave that blank for right now. But B is trying to communicate to A. And so while B is communicating to the switch, B to A, that's fine. C can tell the switch, here's my data, and so there's our C to A packet. And D is doing the same thing. But on this next result, it's time now for the switch to deliver the data back to A. And if we were to look at what that looks like up here, back in our original example, when the switch is trying to send stuff to C, the link from the switch between C and the switch is now going to have that A to C packet. And when the switch is done sending along this B to D packet, it's going to actually send it on to D. So this B to D packet is going to go. And when the switch is done doing the C to A and the A link is available, we're going to see C to A. And finally, we're going to see the D to B. And again, at the second time interval, we're fully occupying all the network links. We're moving another 4 gigabit per second of useful data. But down here, we were able to get all of these packets into the switch, but the switch can't send all of them all at once. So for instance, at this next time interval, The switch is going to be able to deliver B to A, but nothing else. On the next time interval, the switch could theoretically deliver C to A, but nothing else. And at the next time interval, the switch, I drew that in the wrong slot. And then finally, in the last time interval, the switch is able to deliver D to A. But then A is probably going to want to send some data back. And so then A is going to try to talk to B. Now, here we finally get to see a little bit of double data or more data. So in this next time interval, we could see, for instance, the switch has that A to B packet, and so it can send A to B while maybe the switch is replying to C. But I mean, you can see how this all kind of becomes very sequential. Whereas up here, we're very parallel. And this is one of the challenges with store and forwarding, or sorry, with packet switching. The exact communication pattern between all the machines at any given instant in time is really going to be a big factor in determining how efficient the packet switching network can be. It can either be very, very good and you can move a ton of data per second, or it can be almost sequential where you only have one machine talking to another machine at any given time. This pattern up here, we actually have a name for something like this. We would call this a peer-to-peer type of arrangement where all of the computers are kind of exchanging data amongst themselves pretty evenly. Unfortunately, down here, A, just by looking at this picture, will typically describe this thing as a server. And then these guys here are all clients. And for a lot of networking tasks, this is the predominant way that we use the internet or use any network. Maybe you have a file server or a web server or a database server, and you have many clients, and they're all trying to get to that one network interface card on that one server for that one database or that one file or whatever the resource is. And so packet switching works best when we can distribute the load among many, many servers, and so we can support many, many clients. And so we'll see that again later on in the semester as we start to look at how do we address networks that look, let's start off looking like this to make them look more like that. The kind of way that we measure the performance of a data line is to measure it in what we call bits per second data rate. And since we're going to exchange messages, one of the things that we're often interested in is how long is it going to take to send a message over a particular data rate. And so we can kind of work ourselves forwards and backwards here. So we have time being expressed as seconds or some other unit of time, but the standard unit of time is seconds. We have some length as the number of bits, not bytes, but bits. Remember that there are 8 bits to a byte. For a number of reasons in networking, we make the assumption that there are 10 bits in a byte. A, it makes the math a lot easier. But B, it also is more correct. Most network transmissions use what's called an 8B, 10B encoding. We use 10 bits to encode 8 bits. It's less error-prone that way. We can detect if there's been a single bit upset somewhere in that transmission. So packets have a length expressed in bits. The transmission media has a rate expressed in some number of bits per second. And here's another weird thing about networks. Because we're doing everything in 10-bit numbers, we also treat all of the scientific prefixes as base 10, not base 2. So when we talk about gigabit per second here, we actually mean 10 to the 9th, not 2 to the 30th. I know that's really confusing. I'm really sorry. That's just kind of the way that we do things. It does kind of make things work out a little bit better math-wise, but it is a change from other courses. So if we know the length of the message, we know the number of bits per second, we know the number of bits, we can calculate the number of seconds, and we can do that just using some simple algebra. And that will give us the time to transmit a message. So a 200-bit message at 10 gigabit per second is going to be 20 nanoseconds. So in the last slide, we were introduced to the formula that relates the a number of bits that are transmitted, the rate at which things are transmitted in time. That formula didn't just arrive out of nowhere. I thought we could maybe do another example of problems that would use this. So for example, let's assume that I have a 100 megabit per second network. And I want to be able to send an Ethernet frame, which is 1500 bytes. And remember we said earlier that oftentimes we look at this thing called 8B, 10B encoding. And normally a byte is 8 bits, but for the purposes of networking, we're going to make it 10 bits. And so this 1500 bytes becomes 15,000 bits. Again, it's because of one network byte is actually 10 bits in its encoding. And we have units here of bits. I have units here of megabits. We'll be able to get those to cancel. I also have unit of time, which is seconds, and I'm going to want to see that unit as well. So even if I didn't have this formula, or I didn't want to remember this formula, I could still just figure it out by following the units. So I want time, and so that means I'm going to want to have time as my end result. And so if I were to write this as a fraction, I have 1 second, and that gives me 100 megabit. So that per is, remember, giving us our division. And I can now try to get rid of the megabits. I don't have anything with megabits. I do have something with bits. So I could theoretically multiply this by another fraction, and we have 1 megabit is equal to 1 times 10 to the 6 bits. Now I have those units cancel. And finally, what I'm left with is I need to get rid of bits. And I do have something with bits in it, which is the number of bits that I'm going to send. And so now I can cancel those out, and I'm left with just time. And so now I can rewrite this formula to be 1500 divided by 100 million. And that's going to tell me the time that it's going to take for a Ethernet frame to be transmitted. I'm sorry, it'd be 15. So now I can kind of roll all of this together into a fraction, and we'll see that I have, this should be 15,000 bits. 15,000 bits all divided by 100 million, or 1 times 10 to the 8th. And if I were to solve this, the answer comes out to be 0.00015. Or, let's see, this is tens, hundreds, thousands. So this would be 1 millisecond. So this is 0.15 millisecond or 150 microseconds. So that data rate formula allows us to calculate the time that it would take to send a certain amount of data. So another way of using this formula is I want to know how fast of a data link do I need to meet some kind of engineering requirement. So let's say that I have a 1 kilobyte data package. So that's 1,024 bytes. And I need that to arrive at the receiver in 100 nanoseconds. Well, I can now use this to find the rate. So remember, the rate is going to be bits per second. So clearly, I need to get something with bits in the numerator and seconds in the denominator. So let's just go ahead and set this thing up. So I want x bits per second is going to end up being, let's say I got time. So we can do 100 nanoseconds. So that's my unit that has my term that has time in it. I want it to be seconds, so I need to multiply that by, let's see, 1 second is 1 × 10⁹ nanoseconds. All right, so if I did nothing else, this is going to tell me seconds. But I need bits. So I need bits to be in the numerator. And so I don't have anything with bits in it, but I do have bytes, and I know I can go from bytes to bits. So we can do 1,024 bytes, capital B. And I can get that to bits by saying that I have 1 byte is equal to 10-bit lowercase b. And now if I do all of that arithmetic, I get this fraction of, this is, let's see, 1 × 10⁻, 1,024 times 10⁻, divided by 100. Oops. And remember, this is going to be bits per second. And after doing that arithmetic, this says that I need a 102 gigabit per second network. One really interesting thing about copper wires is that the speed of light is not a universal constant, but it's a constant that depends on the transmission media. So the speed of light is about 300 million meters per second in a vacuum, but it's actually quite a bit slower in copper. So it's only, you know, a measly 200 million meters per second. But what we can do is we can actually look at things like how long a frame is. Like we can actually measure the length of a frame, like in meters. We can measure the length of a bit in meters. We can look at how many bits can be on a wire at a time. Or we can look at how long it takes for a whole packet to travel down a wire. And that's going to be what we call propagation delay. For the most part, we tend to ignore propagation delay, mostly because the wire runs that we're looking at are short relative to that propagation delay. And there are other terms that are much, much greater orders of magnitude than propagation delay. So for the most part, we ignore it until we can't. So on the next slide, we'll do a couple of examples of some fun with the speed of light and copper. Okay, I thought we could kind of continue on with some of the information that we learned about in this last slide. We found that the speed of light in copper is 200 million meters per second, or 2 × 10⁸ meters per second, which is just kind of mind-numbingly fast. So let's just think about some of the implications of this. First of all, let's say that I have a wire that is 100 meters in length. How long does it take for the wavefront to begin propagating down that wire? So basically what we're saying is we have this big long wire, and from the time that I start sending ones and zeros, how long is it going to take for this guy to wind up over here on the receiver? And I guess it would look like that, you know, whatever else comes after. Well, again, as we've done before, I know that I want time, and so I can do 1 second over 2 × 10⁸ meters and multiply that by 100 meters, and that's going to give me the answer. And let's see. This is actually the same thing as 1 × 10⁻². 1 × 10⁻² divided by 2 × 10⁸ is going to be 0.5 × 10⁻⁶. And so while the speed of light certainly seems fast, this is going to come out to be 0.5 microsecond. So in the last the last thing we showed was how long it takes for that wave front or that first bit to propagate down the wire. We can use the same strategy now, and I'm interested in knowing what is the length of a single bit. Well, we want something with length, and what we were given was that 2 × 10⁸ meters per second. And what I need to do is get those seconds to cancel out. And that would leave me with meters, and that would tell me exactly how big the bit is, the length of the bit. What I have is I have something with seconds. That was that gigabit. So in 1 second, we could do 1 × 10⁹ bits. Now, the units I'm left with right now are technically meter bits, and I don't want that. So what I can do is multiply all of that by the length of 1 bit. That's what I want to solve. And that leaves me with meters. If we take 2 × 10⁸ meters per second and divide that by 1E9, that comes up to be 0.2 meters. Now there are 100 centimeters in a meter, so this is going to be the same thing as 20 centimeters. So at 1 gigabit, we could actually take out a tape measure and measure 20 centimeters along a blue wire, and that's going to tell me how big 1 bit is. And it's just by virtue of that 1 bit traveling down the wire at the speed of light and copper that we're able to get 1 gigabit per second. Now that we have the length of a single bit, I'm also really interested to know how many bits fit onto that 100 meter wire that we started with? Well, if we take 100 meters and I simply divide that by the 0.2 meters of a single bit, that'll tell me how many bits. And so it's going to end up being 100 divided by 0.2 is 500. So that's really, I think, kind of surprising. If I were to draw a close approximation to a network cable, we have bit number one followed by bit number two followed by bit number three all the way up here to bit number 499 followed by bit 500. And every one of these guys is 0.2 meters. And so when you think about it, at the time that the transmitter is putting this 500th bit onto the wire, the first bit is just being received by the transmitter at this length. And so even though we really try to keep all of these things correlated in time, if we're going to start getting down to look at what's happening on the wire, then this propagation delay becomes really, really important. On the other hand, if we go back to the idea of I have a 100 meter long cable and I want to move that Ethernet frame across it, and it was 0.15 microseconds, that's not a terribly long time. And so sometimes we just kind of ignore propagation delay. Compared to all of the other delays, it just doesn't seem to matter. Now, if you've done networking in the past and you're suffering through this lecture, I'll point out that you can't have a 100 meter long 1 gigabit link. That's out of spec. But that's a different chapter and a different lesson for a different day.